Now, I love the idea of the Morrison government cutting through red tape, regulation, well, the same, of course, in triplicate when it comes to the environment, and green tape. Susan Ley is the relevant minister, and I'm pleased to say, is in the studio with us. You're doing overtime. Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure, Paul. A real pleasure to be here.
Love to have you here. All right, so what is an example of green tape that stands in the way of projects and things actually getting done?
You might be a new LNG project. You might be a strategic assessment for outer metropolitan areas, Western Sydney Airport, development on the edge of town. Whatever is that sort of scale that requires an assessment under the EPBC Act, where we look at matters of national environmental significance, biodiversity, conservation, etc. The point is, the average delay or the average time taken for these major projects to be assessed is 3.5 years. So, you know, I don't mind how big it is, and I don't mind, well, I do mind how important it is, but the efficiency and the challenges that proponents face, I mean, you think of that investment just parked. While an assessment process might take up to 3.5 years, we've estimated that it's costing the economy maybe $300 million a year in delays.
Because this is what's important to note, right, which is, you know, you as a government or anyone, you're not going to tick off on something that's bad for the environment and just because you put an application in, fine, you get it. But it's about, is it correct in saying, it's about making sure that I'll know if it's a yes or no way sooner in the process, so I know that I'm getting on with business or I'm going to have to move it somewhere else. Because the Adani situation, obviously mining, not necessarily environmental, perfect example of, we've got the money, we own the land, 10 years waiting till you can actually dig it up.
1,041 days for Adani. And you're right, Paul, it doesn't matter whether you're the proponent and you want it to go ahead or you're an advocacy environmental group who, for your own perfectly valid reasons, you don't want it to go ahead. The Act is protecting the environment. So I want to make this clear because people think that somehow we're looking for loopholes and ways around that protection. That protection is important and it's central to the Act. But you can't tell me that waiting 3.5 years is reasonable. It just isn't. And some of these developments, and I mention LNG because there's few projects going ahead, there's mining, there's all sorts of things happening that boost our economy, boost our supplies of energy. And if we're going to get on with them, we don't need these delays. Now, there are conditions attached to protect the environment, water tables, biodiversity, threatened species, etc. So people manage within those conditions, but they just need to know what they have to deal with and they need to know it in time.
How do you, as minister, work out the difference between the frog that is worth holding up the whole damn show for versus the frog that we just should either move around or move over or know that it exists somewhere else? Because we know all of these little, these seemingly small things that hold up big things.
If the species is on our threatened species list, it might be endangered or critically endangered, that obviously gives it more prominence in a biodiversity offset management plan. What I'm trying to get across here is that the development may still proceed. The proponent will provide offsets of the habitat. So in the case of Adani, where people were very worried about the black-throated finch, what I'm explaining is that Adani is creating what's called a biodiversity offset of, I think, 28,000 hectares for the finch. So it's making sure that while the activity, the mining activity, might disturb something's habitat, we're fixing it up somewhere else. Not just because we can, but because we should. So these things are very carefully worked through. Again, it comes back to why is it taking so long?
Now, you've been around politics long enough to know that the truth of it is that it's incremental improvements. Things can go very badly very quickly, but incremental improvements. At a point in time, 200 years from now, let's be very optimistic for everyone. How will you look back upon your time as an environment minister? Do you have an idea that, look, geez, I'd love if our rivers were 5% cleaner, there was, you know, Y percent this? How are you going to judge it?
Well, I always say, Paul, ministers come and go, so we should never get ahead of ourselves about how important we are in the continuum. However, we all like to think of things that we could make a difference with. And for me, apart from my local area and the farming communities that I represent and am so, so supportive of in this difficult time, on a broad scale, plastics in the ocean. The Prime Minister spoke at this at the UN, and micro and nanoplastics that are getting into our food chain are potentially going to do an incredible amount of harm. But the good thing is that we can do something about this, and we can do something hands-on to protect our environment. So, yes, that's a big picture, but locally around the country, just to see those groups stepping up, and we're funding them, we're supporting them. We're not allowing them to point at government and say, do this. We're saying, you know how to protect your environment, whether it be planting trees, picking up litter, stopping sediment going into the Great Barrier Reef, that hands-on stuff.
Yeah.
It really does make a difference. You add that up around Australia and it is massive.
Because, well, I'm sure that somebody will scream at the TV for me saying this. The truth is that I think that the concept of the environment has been hijacked by climate change and all of the politics and all of the debate and all of the issues around that. I think that there is virtual unity around the country about the absolute want to have a clean river, to have clean air, to have all of those types of things. How important is it that we start to reconnect with the concept that climate change is one thing, but basic environmental incremental improvements or protections is something that automatically most Australians would support?
They do, and you only have to look at their response to our recycling agenda. So waste, the Prime Minister has put that as one of our key deliverables. We've got a ban on paper, plastic, glass and tyres leaving Australia. We're going to set the timetable next week when I meet Environment Ministers. It's our waste, it's our responsibility. It is all about recycling, remanufacturing, waste to energy when you can't do the recycling part anymore and so on. But what's so exciting is that when I talk to people, when I talk to state governments, there's no politics in it. People are ready to do it.
Yeah.
They're not, you know, they want to know. They want to have the confidence. Very simple, isn't it? When you put something in your recycling bin, that it actually gets recycled and it doesn't go to landfill. And people are ready to play their part in exactly the same way as they're ready to come out on weekends and look after their local environment.
Correct. When you're talking about the area that you represent and that you're around, Albury, Wodonga, all that sort of area, there are a lot of people hurting when it comes to the drought. What do people tell you when, I mean, we hear a lot about what people want from government. You're the person they'd knock on the door of. What do they want?
They want someone to understand what their life is like, and I believe, as government members, we do. In my area, well, I was a farmer for 17 years. I know what it's like to have to shoot your own sheep. I know what it's like to sell a herd of dairy cows. I know what it's like to look at that pile of bills on the kitchen window and think, how on earth am I going to get across this? And I see farm families talking less, going out less, just, you know, the levels of anxiety. So any way we can get in there and bring people together. But I think that's the key thing, and that's the message from our government. We do care. I mean, I can tell you, Paul, because I'm in the conversations, we talk about the drought and how we can better support rural communities all the time, individually, in the corridor, in formal meetings and so on. And, you know, the PM's made it very clear, when we need to do more, we will do more.
Minister, thank you so much for coming along. I look forward to seeing you again very, very soon on
TV.
And off as well. Thank you very much. Sussan Ley is the Minister for the Environment, cutting green tape. Common sense, I like this.